Professor Eric Williams is the chair of the Department of Criminology and Criminal Justice Studies, and that in itself is worth a medal. His courses at the university consider such topics as constitutional law, the Supreme Court, and punishment and corrections. Dr. Williams earned his Ph.D. in political science at Rutgers University. That's Jersey. His writings on prisons and rural communities have appeared in academic journals and newspapers across the country, including the Los Angeles Times. His book, The Big House in a Small Town, was published in 2011, and he is currently working on his next book, Critical and Ethical Thinking for Criminal Justice Professionals, and that's going to be published by the University of California Press. Dr. Williams is here with us today to speak about a very timely topic, international war crimes. He is the recent recipient of our Excellence in Teaching Award right here at Sonoma State, and you're about to find out why. Please welcome Professor Williams.
Oh, that's gonna kill me. All right, how are we now? We're okay? All right, good. So anyway, I was just thinking on my way over here, as a couple of you in the room know who've had me, I'm actually on a partial medical leave this semester, so I'm not teaching any classes, and I'm on a sabbatical all next year. And so I realized that this is the last Sonoma State class I will teach until August of 2017, which rocks. No, I'm kidding. I'm looking forward to my sabbatical, but I will miss teaching. It is just, it's a little odd to think that it's gonna be that long, because for 8 years now, not a single criminal justice student has gotten through Sonoma State without taking me twice, which I don't think most of them have enjoyed, but they've gotten through it and it's been fine. This lecture, when I first got here, you know, when I was very much a rookie and a new professor in the criminal justice department, for some reason, which is she's never fully explained to me, Professor Goodman asked me if I would come and give a lecture in this hall at this time. And at the time, I didn't think much of it. I figured it was just a favor a professor was asking for, you know, a regular old class. And then I started looking year after year at the level of speakers that were brought in, and the fact that she kept asking me to come back, and the fact that Professor Parnes has asked me to come back. And so over the years, it really means a lot to me to be here. I'm not sure when I was a student, I appreciated the speakers that came in from other schools and how much, you know, I was getting from them. And to be, you know, really on a stage and the same stage that some of these incredible people that you bring in, I'm really honored that I get to keep coming back. The other reason why it means so much to me is because I'm not somebody who teaches Holocaust studies. I'm the criminal justice department's law nerd. I'm not even really a criminal justice guy. I kind of fake it here for the last 8 years. My degree is in political science. It's in a subfield of political science called public law. I didn't specialize in international law, but I am Jewish, and I was raised in a relatively Orthodox family. And from the time I was very young, the Holocaust was something almost bordering on an obsession for me. And as a matter of fact, I study prisons to this day, and if you really forced me to sort of analyze why it is a human being would want to walk around prisons and study them, part of the reason was the sort of fear I had as a 7, 8, 9, 10-year-old of a world of total domination, because that's really what I saw when I thought about the Holocaust. And this really came home to me last year. I was very surprised. I take a group of students to London with Professor McEwen from the Political Science Department to Europe. We're doing this now for the second time. And last year we went to Amsterdam. I had never been to Amsterdam before. and we were scheduled to go to the Anne Frank house, which I was rather looking forward to. I had read the Diary of Anne Frank as a kid, but I didn't think that much else of it, except it was gonna be another part of the tour. And we walk in, and you go into the house, and you start to walk up these incredibly steep steps, and they're wooden steps. And I grew up in Maine, and I grew up in an old colonial house with wooden steps. And I remember when I was very, very young, when my parents would come up the steps, when I'd been reading, whether it was Night or one of the other books about the Holocaust that I used to read as a nine-year-old, as scary as that sounds, I would hear the footsteps, and I would get scared, because I would think of what it would be like had I been born in a different place at a different time as a kid who wore a yarmulke, who was an Orthodox Jew. And the only reason I remember that today and how scary that was is because the minute I stepped on those steps at the Anne Frank house and I heard the creak, it brought me back to when I was 8 years old. I couldn't believe it. I started crying. You've had me in a class. Am I particularly warm and fuzzy, Andrew? No, I'm not particularly warm and fuzzy. I couldn't hold back. I started crying, and I sort of walked through the house very quickly as you can with the crowds there. But I tell you that story because this is a topic that means a lot to me. Now, the talk I'm going to give today is going to be about Nuremberg and about international law. But really, the reason why I feel like I've continued to do this and the reason why I want to continue to do this is because of the passion I have for this topic. Because what I love about having this program at Sonoma State and having this center at Sonoma State is the fact that we should never forget. And so the fact that generations of students can continue to listen to, you know, people like me get up here and babble about things that really matter to us and learn something from us, I think.
treat other country soldiers. So, as it turns out, the Germans were quite, they were pretty good to the United States soldiers that they captured. The Japanese were not nearly as good to our soldiers, but the Germans were not very good to the Polish, Russian, and other Slavic soldiers that they captured along the way. They treated them quite horrendously, in some cases as badly as they did, you know, the Jews. So this is war crimes. This is we treated soldiers who we fought against terribly. And the final one, and it really is in many ways the final one, is this new thing which is called crimes against humanity. This is this idea that systematically killing millions of people has to somehow violate a law some way. Right? That somehow this idea that you can take people and put them in trains and take them to camps and work them to death or put them in gas chambers and systematically kill an entire people has to violate some law. But oddly enough, the Nazis were very careful about how they went about their business. The Germans actually believed in a rule of law to a certain extent. And so if you look at the countries where the greatest atrocities took place, they didn't take place in Germany. They would take place in Poland, which was occupied, and therefore the military was ruling rather than the German government. And so they were very careful to try at least to follow the laws that they put in place at the time. Now, they did say that they wanted the trials to at least be somewhat fair. I wouldn't say that they were completely fair, but they did their best to make them at least somewhat fair. And so they allowed, at first they were allowing the defendants to choose any attorney as long as it wasn't a former Nazi party member. But as it turns out, that pretty much meant that there weren't any attorneys in Germany that could represent them. And so they ended up even allowing former Nazis to represent anyone on trial. They were barred from using what were probably the two best defenses they could have used under what's called a common law system. One is a defense called tu quoque, which is an idea that if somebody charges you with something under civil litigation, let's say, if somebody sues you, then you point back at them and say, but you did the same thing. You did it too. And so we weren't going to allow the Nazis to get up there and say the Americans had their own atrocities, because that wasn't the game we wanted to play. The other thing that we didn't really want them, or that the judges weren't going to take very seriously, was the idea that they were under duress, which means they were just following orders. And although many of the military leaders who went on trial said, we were just following orders, the judges didn't take those defenses very seriously. All right, so let's talk about the judges a little bit. This is Lord Jeffrey Lawrence. He was the chief judge. He was picked in many ways because the Americans, well, really the British were worried that this was going to become an American show. We had already decided that Robert Jackson was going to be the person, the chief prosecutor. Francis Biddle, who actually had taken over Jackson's job as Attorney General after Jackson was put on the Supreme Court. Francis Biddle, who was the American judge, assumed that he was going to be the chief judge. Jeffrey Lawrence, other than having been a member of the House of Lords, had a pretty undistinguished career. And so people were really quite surprised when he ended up being appointed chief judge. As it turns out, he did an excellent job and made quite a name for himself through being judge. Our major, the United States, put Francis Biddle as our main judge. He was pretty cranky about the fact that he wasn't the head judge, but he didn't have much of a career afterwards either. Nikitchenko, the judge from the Soviet Union, is actually quite interesting, only for a couple reasons. One reason why he's really interesting is that he did very little without calling home to figure out what he was supposed to be doing. And the rumor had it that Stalin basically gave him his orders. And he ended up dissenting from the final ruling because he was mad that a couple of people were acquitted. Other than that, he didn't really have that much to do with the trials themselves. He did, however, become somewhat famous again. I'm not sure, have any of you guys seen the movie Bridge of Spies? It came out and won an Academy Award. I showed it to some people. Bridge of Spies is a movie of which actually the main character that Tom Hanks played, he was an attorney at Nuremberg, Bill Donovan. Nikitchenko was actually the prosecutor in the Soviet Union who prosecuted Francis Gary Powers. That's the only other reason that he was somewhat famous. The French judge was very French and did very little except for showing up. What ended up, I can't help but make fun of the French. Such easy target. What was agreed upon in London? The French and the Soviets didn't like the idea of having really an American or British style trial. And what they really didn't like was the idea that a jury would get to decide things. And so what we kind of worked out was this strange amalgam of both the French and Soviet systems, as much as there was a Soviet system, and the American and British systems, which are a lot more similar, which is that the judges actually acted as a jury. The judges were also allowed to ask questions, which doesn't happen in the United States, but does happen in France. But we still allowed a prosecution and a defense to be sort of adversarial. We have an adversarial system. I'm sure most of you have seen Law and Order at some point in your life, so you know what that looks like. But that's not what necessarily the system in France looks like. So it was, to a certain extent, a bit of a compromise. As I said, Robert Jackson was the chief attorney. He was the chief prosecutor. He was a fascinating guy. He died fairly young. I think he was 54 years old when he died. He died at 5 o'clock in the morning at his secretary's house. When the Supreme Court sort of got heard that he had died at 5 o'clock in the morning at his secretary's house, they told the press that he was on the way to the store at Sears and Roebuck at that time of the morning and had to stop by his secretary's house to pick up some papers. Then people pointed out, do you really have to pick up papers at 5 in the morning and what store is open then? So it didn't work so well. But Robert Jackson was an attorney. He's interesting in that he's the last Supreme Court justice in history never to have graduated law school. He didn't graduate law school. He went the apprenticeship route, which was a route a lot of lawyers took back in the day. He was very proud of that. He had been a sort of a small-town lawyer. His first case, I think he got paid in cows, which I find very interesting. But he was known as sort of the court's pragmatist, which means he was a guy who believed more in outcomes than he did in the word and the rule of law. That outcomes were what really mattered. That making sure the right policies were what really mattered. And so Nuremberg, in many ways, was his baby, because it really wasn't about making sure that this wasn't an ex post facto law. It was really about making the symbolic point that they wanted to make in Nuremberg. Unfortunately, Robert Jackson also had not been in a courtroom except as a judge for the better part of 2 decades by the time the Nuremberg trials place, and he got beat up quite a bit when he was trying to cross-examine, especially Hermann Göring. Hartley Shawcross, who was from the United Kingdom, he was probably the most effective of the prosecution team. He had this very kindly British way, but really went at the defendants quite well. No reason to talk that much about the Soviets or the French. Moving right along, let's talk about the defendants. This is the defendants actually sitting in the dock. This is the highest ranking Nazi that we managed to get. It's Hermann Göring. I'll talk about him in a second, but there he's sitting there next to Rudolf Hess, and they were at one point in time Hitler's number two and number three. By the end of the war, neither one of them was quite that way anymore, but they were the highest ranking Nazis we managed to catch. So I'm going to talk about them. I'm going to talk about the defendants in groups, in part because the sad thing is that we really didn't get the Nazis we wanted. The Nazis we really wanted were Hitler, obviously, Himmler, Goebbels, Eichmann. These were the guys we really wanted to put on trial. And instead, what we managed to do was put on substitutes for them. And so the sort of Hitler substitutes were Göring and Rudolf Hess. Göring was a fascinating character. He was already fairly well known in the United States because he was such a flamboyant guy. He was kind of the clown prince of Germany. He used to wear these. You can kind of see the color of his suit here. That's why I tried to pick a colored picture. He used to wear these like powder blue uniforms that were really very garish, and he would change his uniforms three times a day so nobody could see him in the same uniform a couple times. He was a very big man. He actually weighed more than I did. He's about 6 inches shorter than me, and I'm not exactly thin. I've seen a video of him. I mean, it's an old film of him at his villa with his pet tiger. He had like a baby tiger that he's petting. He stole a ton of art from throughout Europe. And, you know, for a long time, he really was the person who was going to take over for Hitler. And we caught him when he turned himself in with 17 suitcases, one of which was filled with 20,000 morphine pills. He had a little bit of a drug problem. And when he was in prison awaiting trial, the Americans decided to get him off drugs and to put him on a diet. And so by the time he went on trial, whereas he had been pretty high when they picked him up and pretty out of it, he was really quite sharp by the time they put him on trial. And he was, in many ways, very devastating to the prosecution. And his cross-examination didn't go anywhere near the way that they had hoped it would. Rudolf Hess is also an interesting figure. He spent pretty much the entire war in an English POW camp. He had this idea that the Brits and the Germans should get along, and that if he just got to Britain, he could convince the British to make peace with the Germans, and then they could turn around and both fight the Soviets. So he stole a plane, or this is the story, and he flew to England and he crash landed it, and he asked to see the Duke of Hamilton, I want to say his name was. We had met once at a party, and he shows up and he says, "Hey, I'm here, I want to make a treaty with you guys, let's work this out." And nobody took him that seriously, so they put him in a POW camp, and he put Hitler in a pretty bad position. Because if Hitler says, "Well, I sent him there," then he's got to say, "Well, we want to have some diplomatic work going on between us and the UK." If Hitler doesn't admit that he went there, then he's got this guy who's sort of a lunatic who's going flying planes in the middle of the night to Europe, to England. So Hitler decides that publicly he's going to state that Rudolf Hess is insane. He says, "Hess was crazy, he stole a plane, he's crazy." Well, if you're a German citizen and the Führer says you're crazy, guess what? You decide that you're crazy. And so Rudolf Hess decided that he had amnesia in 1941, that he didn't remember flying to England, that he didn't remember anything of his life before 1941, and yet he spent the entire war in an English POW camp writing letters to his wife every single day. And his claim was that he didn't actually remember his wife, but he was copying her name off of the letters that he had received. Okay? And has kept this going all the way almost to the trial. And he tried to plead insanity. And so he told the judge that he was insane and therefore he shouldn't go on trial until the judge decided that he would give him a psychological evaluation. And his lawyer and the psychologist sit down with him and they say, by the way, if you're granted this insanity plea, you're not going to be able to hang out with your friends anymore, all of your co-defendants, you're going to go off, you're going to go straight to an insane asylum. Guess what Hess does? Oh, I'm not sane anymore, I'm not sane anymore. All of a sudden you remember. So he could go to court. And then the day after he was convicted, oh, I'm crazy. And Hess actually was the longest lasting of the Nuremberg defendants. He was sentenced to life, and he ended up dying. He was in his early 90s, and he died in the same prison he'd been held since the trial, and he committed suicide when he was in his early 90s. Seems a little redundant at that point, but besides the point. But these were really the stand-ins for Hitler. The propagandists were really stand-ins for Goebbels. Julius Streicher was the editor of a magazine called Der Spermer. He was probably the most disliked of all of the defendants. The claim was that he didn't bathe very often, that his cell smelled. He also was kind of an idiot when, in 1940, he got into an argument with Himmler in public and decided to write this paper that, he got into a fight with Goering in public and decided to write this paper that Goering was impotent and that his oldest son was not his own. And Goering got a little upset with him and threw him in jail and fired him from his job and kicked him out of the Nazi party. Alfred Rosenberg, this was the other sort of stand-in for Goebbels. He was the chief Nazi philosopher. These were guys who, although despicable human beings, weren't really involved in much of the day-to-day destruction or decision-making in terms of the war. The henchmen, these were the stand-ins for Himmler, and in many ways I think these two were probably the two guys that the United States wanted the most. Hans Frank was the Governor General of Nazi-occupied Poland. He was known as the Jew Butcher of Krakow. The stories about him and his exploits in killing people were horrendous. He's interesting in that I think he may be the one of the people in the main Nuremberg trial who actually felt some remorse. He rediscovered his Catholicism when he was in prison, and supposedly he felt very guilty about what went on. Ernst Kaltenbrunner, I always struggle to say his name, was the chief of the security police, and the newspaper and newsreel people loved him. He was absolutely exactly what they thought a Nazi should look like. He was about 6'3", he was blonde, he had blue eyes, and you can kind of see the scar on his face right here, and if you could see it a little bit better, it was a really deep purple. And he used to tell people that he had gotten into a fight when he was young, and that's how he got it, somebody broke a bottle across his face. He admitted when he was in prison, the truth was he had gotten drunk one night, drove off in a car, ran into a tree, and put his face through the mirror. So that's how he ended up actually getting the cut. But he was central casting for what a Nazi was supposed to look like. Alfred Jodl and Wilhelm Keitel were really the high command of the Nazi military. The slave drivers, Albert Speer and Fritz Sockel, were basically, Speer, I mean, his title is Reich Minister of Armaments and Munitions, which may sound like he's just building, you know, guns and things like that. Actually, what he did was make sure that there were slaves around to be able to build armaments and munitions. And Sauckel's job was slave labor recruitment. I've always loved that term, which meant he made sure to get the slaves where Speer needed them. Speer actually Yeah. He didn't end up being executed. He was sentenced to 20 years. He only served 8. And then ended up coming to the West and wrote a bestseller about his life, which is lovely. Shocked and funked were the industrialists. If you need slave labor, you gotta have somebody who actually like owns the rubber plant that's using the slaves. And these were the guys who sort of represented the capitalists or the industrialists. And so we got, in that first Nuremberg trial, a little bit of every part of Nazi society that we were gonna put on trial here. This is just a quote from Robert Jackson's opening statement. It is the one part of the trial where he was fantastic. I don't recommend watching all of it. It's 8 hours long, so it's a little lengthy for, you know, 2016 years, but I really always like this quote. "The wrongs which we seek to condemn and punish have been so calculated, so malignant, and so devastating that civilization cannot tolerate their being ignored because it cannot survive their being repeated." And the rhetoric is wonderful. I think the sad part is that what we have seen is that some of them have in fact been repeated. Jackson's biggest mistake was that the prosecution's case was mainly documentary. He hired some 600 lawyers to come and represent the prosecution. He had all of these documents. The Nazis were obsessive about saying everything that they were doing. And so you have the death book from Mauthausen, which lists every single concentration camp victim that they killed. Now, it doesn't say that they killed them. You just had 50 people dying of a heart attack at the same minute at the same time. But they did list all of the names of everybody that they killed there. And so you have all of this evidence of all of these atrocities. And so Robert Jackson just thought to himself, well, as long as we have the documents, that's how we're going to make sure to win this trial. The problem is, I imagine what it's like to sit in court day after day after day as somebody just reads a document, it gets translated, somebody reads a document, it gets translated. And eventually, Jackson was convinced that they needed to do a little bit more than just blow people away with the amount of paper that they have. And so, while the sort of atrocities committed against the Jews and the gypsies and the homosexuals were sort of besides the point, they decided that they were going to have to make sure that they put on witnesses that saw these things. That really the world wanted to hear about what the Nazis had done. Okay? The defense, different people did different things. Goering was defiant to the end. He was the most difficult of the defendants to deal with. His cross-examination was probably a loss for the prosecution. Hess claimed again that he was insane. Speer and Frank said were repentant. Keitel and Jodl claimed that they were military men just following orders. Funk and Sokol claimed that they didn't know any knowledge. And the biggest thing that they all did was blame Hitler, blame Himmler, blame Goebbels, blame Eichmann. Hitler was dead, Himmler was dead, Goebbels was dead, and Eichmann was on his way to Argentina, but we thought he was dead. And so the idea was, if I blame them for what happened, maybe I won't end up being hanged. Well, as it turns out, 11 of the defendants were sentenced to death by hanging. There were 3 acquittals. The other gets prison terms from 10 years to life. Okay. The verdicts were handed down in October. 12 days later, all of the appeals were rejected, so I'm sure the judges took lots of time with those. Goering, when his appeal was rejected, he asked to be killed by firing squad, because it turns out that is the most noble way to be executed. I don't really want to be executed by any means, but he did not want to be hanged. He felt it was beneath him. And with the help, they think, of his American guard, he was able to get into his luggage, not into the morphine pills, but somewhere in his luggage he had hit a cyanide pill. And he took it and he committed suicide the day before the other 10 were hanged. The 12 other war crimes trials were actually, they ended up doing 12 war crimes trials that took place from 46 to 49. There were 30 that were planned. By 1949, though, the Germans, the West Germans, were kind of sick of these trials still taking place. And they asked the United States to stop. And by the time the smaller war crimes trials were taking place, it was a completely different situation that was going on in Germany. First of all, the United States and the Soviet Union weren't getting along nearly as well anymore. That was sort of turning. But also, whereas the first Nuremberg trial, you had a Supreme Court justice, and you had, you know, some members of the House of Lords. For the other war crimes tribunals, you really kind of got the B team. And so they weren't televised. They weren't written about as much in the newspapers. They weren't shown as much in the newsreels. And so really, by the early 1950s, we had kind of lost our taste for prosecuting the Nazis. And besides that, we needed some of the former Nazis for our own nuclear plans and other things. So they started to wind down in 1949. After that, the Israelis were, Israel became a country, and it was one of the countries, or it was the country, that really wanted to keep going after Nazi war crimes. And so, in Israel, the only crime for which you can be executed is for crimes against humanity, specifically being a Nazi. And the Israeli Secret Service went after Eichmann. Actually, they went after Eichmann and Mengele, both who were living in South America. Mengele was the doctor at Auschwitz. Eichmann, it's hard to get an idea of exactly what Eichmann did. Eichmann really did make sure the trains ran on time going to and from the concentration camps. I think we thought he was a much higher ranking individual than it turned out he was. There were stories about Eichmann that he had grown up in Palestine and he spoke Hebrew and all these crazy things, and it turns out he wasn't really all that smart. But the Israelis found him living in Argentina. He was actually fairly poor, and they kidnapped him and threw him on an LL flight and brought him back to Israel, which is actually a very interesting story, which I won't go all the way into here. But they brought him back, he was put on trial in Israel, and he was eventually executed. There were also later trials in Dachau and Auschwitz that were held in Germany. And you know, throughout the 50s and 60s, from time to time, the West Germans would decide to hold some trials, and then from time to time, they would decide that they weren't going to do it anymore. I think that the most important thing to remember about Nuremberg is that it really was the first time the international community came together and put people on trial for what they did during a time of war. And I think that in some ways, Nuremberg, its biggest success was as a symbolic means of showing the world that this is something that maybe could be done. However, it wasn't really attempted again until 1992 with the International Court of Justice and the International Criminal Tribunal, which specifically was put into place to deal with the atrocities in Bosnia. And in many ways, the International Criminal Tribunal for Bosnia has been the most successful of all of the international criminal courts. They indicted over 160 individuals. Many of them were leaders, including these two, Milosevic and I'm going to mispronounce his name. You can say it better than that. Yes. They managed to get the leaders who committed the atrocities in Bosnia in a way that very even in Nuremberg we were not able to. That they had 81 convictions. And in 1996, when we were going through what was going on in Bosnia and having this international criminal tribunal, we first started discussing the idea that maybe we need an international criminal court. Maybe this is something we shouldn't just put together from time to time. And in 1994, as the first trials were taking place in Bosnia, we had the atrocities in Rwanda. Did they talk about that all this time? Okay. so they know a little bit about it. I don't think there's, I don't want to downplay what happened in Bosnia, but what happened in Rwanda was unlike anything I think we had ever seen before, in that 800,000 people were killed in 100 days. I mean, if you think about that, that is more than the entire population of San Francisco dead in 3 months. I mean, think about that. And so Rwanda was this just horrendous moment in time. And so between the International Criminal Tribunal in Bosnia and the one that was created for Rwanda, we started to understand that maybe it's necessary to have a standing court to deal with war crimes and atrocities, and specifically with genocide. Now, Rwanda also did something else that was very interesting, in that they created something called, and I'm sure I'm mispronouncing, but it's the Gacaca courts, which are local courts focused on restorative justice and reconciliation. Gacaca means blowing grass. I don't know why the hell that means court, but it does. But the Gacaca courts in Rwanda were specifically aimed at very local restorative justice. And trials happened. There was one story of a trial happening at a wedding where the best man got up there and a woman said, "You killed my son." And then another guy who was at the wedding said, "No, he didn't kill your son. My brother killed your son." And some woman came forward and said, "He's right, his brother killed his son." And they had a Gacaca court right there. And the idea behind the Gacaca courts were, if you agreed to basically plead guilty, your sentence would be cut in half, and half of the time you would have spent in jail, you instead were supposed to do some kind of restorative justice for the community that you hurt. And where Bosnia, they had a difficult time going after the people on the ground who pulled the trigger to kill the Muslims, in Rwanda, these Gacaca courts were actually very successful in doing that. And so in 2002, we have the creation of the International Criminal Court. 148 countries came together and signed a statute in the late 1990s arguing for the creation of the International Criminal Court. 114 member states had actually signed on to the International Criminal Court. Do you know what one of the biggest countries not to sign on to the International Criminal Court is? The United States. The United States was part of the original group of countries that signed the statute, but they refused to take part in the International Criminal Court unless our people were exempt from prosecution. So we basically said, we will support it as long as you don't actually prosecute anybody, any of our people. Which is kind of ridiculous. If you're going to support it, support it. But Russia at this point doesn't support it, Israel doesn't support it. But we do have 114 member states. They have had 10 official investigations. This is the list of countries. There have been 39 indictments, 2 convictions, and 9 acquittals. I want to show you a map. The green are the countries where there have been indictments in the International Criminal Court. The red are places where investigations have taken place. Do you notice anything about where the indictments have happened, the green countries? It's a very African group that is before the International Criminal Court. And one of the big complaints about the International Criminal Court has been the main focus on really developing countries, especially those in Africa. I have mixed feelings about the International Criminal Court. I think that it is an important symbolic institution to have, but without as much worldwide support, I don't know how much it can do. But I want to just finish up here by talking about some of the continuing issues in war crimes tribunals. First of all, the lessons of Nuremberg, I think, are difficult to kind of wrap our head around. Nuremberg was unique. We had never seen anything like it in international law. International law really didn't exist at the time of Nuremberg. I think that Nuremberg was, it kind of shows you what can happen when the world comes together and sends its best lawyers and its best legal minds together to try to fight for justice, whatever that tended to mean. And what we've seen since, whether it's the International Criminal Tribunals, although the one in Bosnia has been probably more successful than any other, or the ICC, is that without those incredible legal minds, we're sort of lacking a little bit. And without the financial support, quite frankly, we're lacking a little bit. But Nuremberg showed us that we could come together and put people on trial for atrocities committed during the wartime. I think one of the things we still struggle with today is what we're trying to accomplish with international criminal law. Are we trying to be vengeful? Do we want vengeance? Because if vengeance is what we want, we probably what Churchill wanted was the right way to go. You know, if we're trying to deter people, I study prisons for a living. I can tell you that prisons aren't much of a deterrence, but neither is execution. So I don't know if that's something that we're achieving with these international courts. If we're trying to gain some semblance of reconciliation, I think we need to look to the Rwandan example to learn something, because I think probably they have been most successful in terms of reconciliation. And I think, just to make one final point, that we, especially in the United States, but I think in the Western world generally, are uncomfortable with the relationship between law, justice, and morality. I often tell students that the Supreme Court is not a court of justice, it's a court of law. And it is certainly not a court of morality. And I think that our legal system generally attempts to come to some semblance of justice under a certain very specific notion of morality. And I think these international criminal courts are a little bit more confused, because our notions of justice do not necessarily match the rest of the world's notions of justice. And so if we can sort of come to some conclusion about what it is we're trying to achieve, and perhaps create courts that are aimed at achieving those goals, I think we'll get a lot farther than we have so far. And with that, I'm going to stop. Any questions? Yes?
Do you think it's problematic to kill criminals on a world stage? Because we find in criminology that with executions, like if we solve killing with more killing, then that introduces called a brutalization effect, where there's actually more killing that results from executions.
So do I think it's, I have to repeat the questions back for them. So do I think it's problematic to kill people on the world stage because of this brutalization effect? I mean, I'm not a proponent of capital punishment, but I'm not crazy about the idea of a state killing its own citizens. How I feel about Churchill's idea of drumhead justice, or executing even the way that we did in Nuremberg, it depends on what you're trying to accomplish. I guess my answer to your question would be, I think at the most what we're trying to accomplish with some of these trials is a semblance of vengeance and also a semblance of reconciliation. I don't think we're trying to deter anyone from doing anything. And so given that, and I don't know how to deter people, and I've been studying criminal justice for 15 years. So I think that, you know, I understand your point that there is this effect that if you kill people publicly, other people are going along, you know, that it doesn't really deter anybody from doing anything. But I also understand those people who lived in a world that I can't even imagine, losing family members in ways that I can't even imagine, wanting a semblance of vengeance, and for the world wanting to be able to satisfy that at least a little bit. I know that sounds harsh, but it doesn't seem to me to be the most terrible thing in the world.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
To publicly show the feelings of Al-Qaeda and ISIS or hand executing people, what would you say that's what the reason was?
So, I'm not sure I understand your question.
We actually had videos.
No, I've seen the video. So there are videos, ISIS, where they publicly ask people by cutting them across the throat. I don't think what they're trying to accomplish, I'm not in tune with what ISIS thinks, thankfully. What they're trying to accomplish, I think, is something very different than a notion of justice, right? They may think that they're achieving it, but I don't think that's what they're aiming for. I think that's a very different.
Al Qaeda, same thing.
Al
Qaeda.
Yeah, no. Whether it's Al Qaeda or ISIS, I think their public executions are more about showing that they can do it than they are about any kind of notion of justice at all. I thought it's something I see a hand back there. Where else? Any questions? Yes, sir.
Was there any sort of equivalent war crimes trial for the Japanese in the
Washington? Yes, there was an equivalent war crimes tribunal for the Japanese. Yes, there were Tokyo war crimes trials. They were not as big as Nuremberg. They were not. Robert Jackson certainly wasn't there. We didn't send like Hugo Black over there to do it. The Japanese atrocities were well documented in those trials, and I think they were probably. I mean, they may have had the same level of success as Nuremberg, but I think the Nuremberg, that main trial in Nuremberg, really captured the world in a way that the Tokyo war crimes trials didn't, and the successor trials in Nuremberg didn't. And I think it really had to do with. I mean, we really did send the A-team. There was a book that came out a few years ago called To Stay the Hand of Vengeance. And the author makes an argument that if Nuremberg was a Major League Baseball team, sorry if you don't like sports, but I'm using a sports analogy. If the Nuremberg, the people who took part in Nuremberg were a Major League Baseball team, every trial that's taken place since then is a pretty good hometown softball team. I mean, that it's not even like you're talking majors and minors here. Like, you're talking, like, me up there versus, you know, Sammy Koufax. So, I think that had Tokyo had the same level of talent, maybe you wouldn't have had to ask that question because you would know, right? And I think that's the unfortunate part today, is that, you know, the ICC has some really good human rights attorneys, you know, the class that we took to Europe, we went to the ICJ last year, which is the International Court of Justice. They're brilliant guys that we talked to. The judges there were amazing, but you're not talking the level of Supreme Court justices taking off time from work to go to work. You know? So that would be really amazing. Yeah.
On that topic, I was just going to mention that one thing we learned in this class was that the Japanese trials were successful because they had actually given the murder here in Zito and just dealt with some of those people.
Yeah, what he said was that the Tokyo war crimes trials weren't quite as successful because of the people we granted clemency to. I would say that's partially true. I think another reason is that the Nazis were much better at documenting exactly what it was they did. And so we had just so much evidence. I mean, just so much evidence that it was just out of control. Other questions? Yes, sir?
I'm more of a situation of ISIS. If you can, like, in escalation, you know, how long the ISIS is going on board, there's like ISIS days or attacking, or they face kind of the same like trial, do you think, in today's time period, or is it going to be a lot more low key or anything?
So his question was, if ISIS leaders were captured, would we put them in front of criminal trials? Osama bin Laden? I'm not trying to be snarky, but I think that kind of answers your question. I think in some ways what we're fighting today you know, I'm starting to go out of my area of expertise, but, you know, we're fighting an asymmetrical war where we're not fighting against the state the way that we were in World War II. We're not fighting against a country. ISIS is, although I think we'd like to be, it's not a country per se. You know, and I think what we seem to have shown in the last 5 years is we're much more comfortable with drones or, you know, targeted assassinations than we are with putting people on trial. So maybe Churchill is right tomorrow. Yes.
I'm just saying that even if the trial, the people being tried are as heinous as these Nazi war criminals, trials still add kind of an air of legitimacy to whomever it is that's being tried, and so to treat terrorist organizations that way would be to legitimize the organizations. I think that's one which kept the discipline apart. States.
The idea being that you legitimize, that you give something, you give a terrorist group much more legitimacy by giving them a trial. I guess, you know, I mean, the funny thing is, the first time I gave this talk, my biggest fear was that somebody was going to ask me the question, like, do you think international war crimes trials are a good idea? And somebody asked me at like year three, and I went into a panic because my answer would be I'm not really sure. I'm a guy who believes in the rule of law, and I'm somebody who, you know, I love the Constitution probably more than I should, and I study the Supreme Court and I read Supreme Court cases for fun, and I really, you know, I've spent my entire adult life dealing with law and criminal justice system, and I'm not sure that the legal model that we use, I understand why we want to use it in these situations, and I understand why we want to use it both when it comes to war crimes and we want to use it when it comes to terrorists. I'm not sure that it's effective in either case. I think it makes us feel good because we put on a good show. I'm not convinced that we achieve very much by doing it, as sad as that sounds. That doesn't mean that my entire lecture was crap.
On that same topic, then, what would you suggest we would do with the prisoners at Guantanamo?
So he's asking what to do with the prisoners at Guantanamo. So that's actually within my area of expertise. The fact that we've held them in Guantanamo is ridiculous because we have the federal government 9 years ago bought a prison in Thompson, Illinois, which is set up and half owned by the Department of Justice, and is waiting for those inmates to show up. It said that Congress passed a law saying that no money can be used from the federal government to pay to transport them to the United States. Now, if there's one thing we know how to do really well, it's put people behind bars and not let them out, as it turns out. And actually, half of this prison that we bought is about to be opened. It's about to go online as a Federal Bureau of Prisons prison to handle their sort of worst of the worst. And so we're spending $1.5 million a year per inmate to hold them in Guantanamo when we could bring them back to the States and spend $100,000 tops, which I'm not saying this is all financial, but the reason we don't do that is because the minute we bring them to what is unarguably United States soil, we have to give them trial. Like, it doesn't matter if we say they're enemy combatants, the case law is pretty straightforward. You bring them on American soil, you give them constitutional rights. I think that's what we should do. I don't know why we haven't, but I think it makes really good political hay, and that's the biggest reason why we don't, is because it really, it's a good fight that both the Democrats and the Republicans love to have, which we're also, by the way, really good at.
Moving off what you've said and what a lot of the students have asked in terms of legitimacy of the International Court of Justice being a state-by-state case basis, but that you mentioning that the ICC is more of a symbolic gesture. As you mentioned, that as we fight more asymmetrical warfare or as there are more conflicts like that, do you see that the progression actually moving towards the ICC holding more legitimacy because of the fact that it's more individual-based and less a state-by-state-based?
So do I think because of asymmetrical wars we will see the ICC model given more legitimacy? If I could go back to that slide, no. You know, I think because the ICC, the way the rules are written, it's almost written in a way that guarantees you go after countries that are in turmoil, that are going through civil war, because you have to agree to allow them in to come and do the investigation in the first place. You know, to go after terrorist groups the way the ICC charter is written, it would have to be completely rewritten. I could go on like that, but I am starting to lose my voice, so I'm going to take one more question and then stop.
My question was, would America ever consider handing over anybody to the ICC, or do we see our court system above their court system?
Would the United States ever hand anyone over to the ICC? No.
I didn't think so.
And it's not a question of our court system being above their court system. There are arguments to be made, you know, it's a complicated issue, right? It's very easy, and I'm sure when I was 21 years old, I would have said, you know, take the president, make him go on trial. Yeah, you know, damn it, you know. I was kind of an asshole like that. I'm a little older now, and I think about the way we look to the rest of the world, right? And do we really want our former president going on trial in The Hague? Like, I'm not very comfortable with that in terms of our future international relations, how that's going to look. You know, the optics of it worry me. But from the United States standpoint, I just can't see us doing it. I mean, you know, the Bush administration didn't want to support it. The Obama administration hasn't made a peep about supporting it. So I just can't imagine.
Actually, if it changed anything, I didn't mean any of our citizens. I mean anyone we might capture overseas.
Do you think if one of our people are captured overseas, I think SEAL team whatever would go and make sure to get that?
No. I mean, if we caught criminals from other countries, would we hand them over?
Yes, if we caught criminals from other countries when we turn them over to the
like
ICC. That's not the way the ICC works, oddly. We would think it did, that we would sort of chase down criminals, and it doesn't work like that. The member nations really have to be heavily involved. And so the nation itself, I'll take one more question before my voice publishes. Excellent question. She said, how can our country have any legitimacy or really, you didn't say this, but play any moral high ground when we won't take part in this process? The answer is we can. I mean, we really can. You know, I understand why we don't support the ICC. It also makes the ICC pretty toothless. You know, if we won't take part, you know, it also makes it very difficult for us to go to African nations and say you shouldn't be treating your citizens like that when, you know, we're not willing to let the world look in on what it is that we're doing. So I think that was, you know, it was a question, but an excellent, excellent point, which is that we don't have that kind of opportunity. Thank you very much.